I'm going to keep this intro short because I can already feel myself dozing off from boredom by introducing this Devlog series. As many of you may not know, I'm somewhat of a game developer myself. Lately, I've been getting that itch for a good-ass RPG that started almost 6 years ago. And you'll come to know that my motto is that if you can't find anything good on Steam, make it yourself. So I'll be documenting the process in which I make an RPG that actually doesn't suck. For now, I'll be calling it Treasure Porters. More on that later. You might be wondering how I plan on making my RPG not suck, and that's actually quite a good question. Simply put, I'll be putting my favorite parts of each RPG type game into one place. This means I'll be taking heavy inspiration from games like League and Dota. I'll explain my reasonings on the way, because I'm pretty sure editor me has no idea what to put for B-roll footage right now. So let's get to the fun part. In the very beginning, there was nothing. Nothing but a Unity project file named Treasure Porters. To spice things up a bit, I put down a simple plane and then placed a lonely, singular bean on top. It was at this moment that I realized that I had forgotten how to do everything Unity related, and all the practice I did from 2019 to 2020 had seemingly gone to waste. I did, after all, come from a background of GameMaker Studio 2, 6 years of it, in fact. But I wasn't going to let a little bit of IDE vertigo stop me from making a game that I believed would capture the true RPG feel. I quickly did what any sane indie developer would do. I hopped onto the Unity Asset Store. It was a place where I could take advantage of other people's kindness and quickly whip up a prototype of my game. Bless the people who put free assets on the Unity Store. I hope to contribute to society in the same manner in the future. After getting the landscape imported in, I started to fiddle around with the camera's positioning like a child pretending to play the violin with the plastic straw and lid at McDonald's. At this point, you may be wondering, how the heck is this buffoon going to make a game at all? Trust me, even I'm hurting watching myself relearn Unity. I think it takes me like 3 days to get back in the groove. I decided that the first thing to do with this newfound terrain was to bake a nav mesh on it. For those who don't know, a nav mesh is a mesh, which is a formation of triangle and vertices, and this mesh helps things navigate. In other words, the only way the little chess pieces on the chessboard know how and where to move is via the nav mesh. You can see me having a little bit of trouble with creating the nav mesh, or baking it, as they call it, and I couldn't figure out why exactly this was happening. I believe it was something along the lines of how the terrain asset handled its own colliders, but it just wasn't cooperating with the nav mesh system. Feeling lost, I looked at the asset store again to replace the terrain when I stumbled upon an RPG builder, but it's $175. But if I get it, I'll probably save hours and hours of time. But at the same time, I'll have to spend time learning how to use the asset too. I resisted the temptation and ultimately decided against the idea. Instead, I opted to make a large plane that was invisible to the player, and used that to bake the nav mesh instead. I then plugged and chugged some scripts into my player object so that I would assign a destination using the Unity AI and agent system when I clicked on the ground. I also put in a few scripts that made the camera follow the player and other tertiary things. And just like that, we have a dude who moves around. He sort of doesn't animate correctly, and also has this weird Tokyo Drift thing going on, but we'll fix it. After fixing the Tokyo Drift thing, I went to work on the animation business. It takes time to set things up for the first time, but once you get through, anytime you want something new animated, all you have to do is just drag and drop, tweak a few values, and everything will work just fine. I'd done this sort of thing before, so getting the dude to look like he was running was smooth sailing. Then I added a health bar, I made the character visually rotate without impeding its actual movement. Sorry, Dota. I love you, and I've gotten used to your turn time being part of movement, but it's one of the things I could do without. And finally, I put down my first enemy type object onto the scene. It didn't really do anything, but I needed it to do one thing. I needed it to take a beating. And after quite a bit of code crunching, I got the result I wanted. It wasn't perfect, but it did the job. But it's not my style to leave things choppy and unpolished, so I went to iron out the wrinkles out of my game with more code crunching and playtesting. Eventually, I tweaked it to the best of my ability, and I was ready to move on. In order for me to make the dragon? I'm gonna call it a boar. Sue me. In order for me to make the board target me, chase me, and attack me, I'm gonna need to establish a lot of systems. I first begin with the movement of the board. If I want the board to start moving towards me, I need to be able to set the destination of the board. Once that's settled, all I have to do is continuously set its destination to be the player when it's within aggro range. And while I was at it, I made the boar animate properly with a click of a few buttons. Somewhere in the middle of handling the boar, I felt like the screen felt a little lonely and I wanted to be able to see a little bit of feedback when I clicked on the map. So I went and made a little Sims looking ass pointer thing that spawned whenever you clicked on the ground and then just sunk into the map, never to be seen again. I thought it would be funny if there was no limit to the map pointers, contrary to other games, and I also noticed that since the pointer was an actual object in the world space, it would cast shadows whenever it appeared. I think these features give it a bit of charm, so I'm gonna let them stay for now. I've made sure not to let the pointer screw with anything in the game. Okay, back to the boar. Now I had them get angry and target you when you got too close, which was what I was looking for. They even had some sort of primitive attack system going on, although they weren't supposed to do it while sliding around. At this point, during playtesting, I started to feel like something was off. In a good way. I noticed that because my game was starting to feel like a genuine MOBA, my fingers would automatically move to certain keys in an attempt to control the movements of my character better. Most notably, the S and A keys. If you don't play MOBAs, these keys simply respond to the stop and attack move commands. The stop key is pretty obvious. This makes your character stop. A lot of veteran players will use this key because it makes it easier to move your character with precision, which helps with dodging attacks or preventing your character from automatically attacking nearby enemies. But the attack move key, that's something else. It makes your character move towards the destination like the normal movement command, but if your character gets into range of an enemy, it locks onto that enemy and begins attacking it, moving closer if it isn't close enough. But why do I need the attack move key in particular? If you don't play MOBAs or RTSs, I apologize for the following sentence, but there's no explaining this one without spending like 15 minutes, so I'm just gonna give it to you guys raw. My muscle memory kept pressing A when I tried to orb walk and kite the boars backwards. I treated this as a good sign since the fact that my muscle memory for MOBAs was kicking in could be taken as an indication that my game was becoming polished and felt good to control. So how was I going to implement this? If you don't like nerd stuff, I can understand since nobody likes nerd stuff, and those who claim to do so, like me, are aliens from Mars. But I'll keep it super short because I think this is interesting even to people who don't program. So programmatically, that's programming, but grammatically correct, by the way. Programmatically, what I had to do was make the character move to its destination while searching around for a certain range of itself for enemies. If it finds enemies, it determines which one is the closest one, and then locks onto that enemy. Simple, right?
And you know what? For a person of my caliber, it really was quite simple for me.
In fact, the funniest part was the fact that I initially expected myself to take like 6 to 8 hours.
But that also meant that if I had 1,000 enemies on the map, it would have to shoot myself 1,000 times before they could decide which enemy to lock onto.
It'd be a problem because the first thing that would only scan objects once they're cast. That also meant that I needed to find some way to only consider these objects.
So that's why you'll never catch the pouring orange juice from a dog in public ever again. Did you get any of that? No? Shame. I really wanted you guys to go through the joy that I felt when I compiled everything and it ran like butter. I was surprised to see that the attack move worked so seamlessly. It was the first time that I coded something and it worked in less than 3 tries. It was the first time, but ever since I sold my soul to the devil, it wasn't ever the last time. That was a pretty long and somewhat taxing segment, so let's take a quick break by watching some boars dance for a while. Somehow, as I continued to develop my game, my skills increased. Less and less problems came along, and I'm proud to say that those results are evident in what's shown on screen. I was getting closer and closer to making my game both playable and fun. One of the things that I envisioned that wasn't in place but could be expanded upon was enemy abilities. In my mind, I wanted the boars to charge forward after huffing and puffing. I looked around for an animation that would suit my needs, and I found this scream animation that worked perfectly. After chugging some code out, I got the boars to charge at the players the way I wanted them to. They're supposed to do a good chunk of damage for hitting the player, probably like 1/6 of the player health bar or something. Oh, whoops. The boar was doing damage 60 times a second for touching the player while charging. I quickly fixed it and I noticed that the scream gave the player way too much time to dodge, so I shortened the amount of time it took to scream and it was looking much better. I made the boars choose to use their charge ability whenever they wanted, using a variable called inclination, and randomized it every time they were created. Once they were all using their charges whenever they wanted to, I began playtesting the whole try to kill them and dodge the charge minigame I had set myself in, and I got obliterated like 20 times in a row. It wasn't the scream that was playing too quickly, since I was still getting my ass handed to me when I slowed down the scream to 5 times its original duration. It was simply too hard to see the boars raise their head to scream. I quickly slapped together an exclamation mark model, splashed some yellow on it, and threw it into Unity. Now that there was an exclamation mark above their heads, it was a lot easier to react to the boars charging, and I started having a lot of fun dodging and weaving between the boars. It's quite interesting how polish can make a game with only 2 or 3 elements really fun. And just like that, I think I can call this chapter of the game development book closed. Movement, character animations, health, damage, enemy targeting, enemy abilities. We've gotten a lot done within these past 15 minutes. And the best part is, only the fun parts will remain. Things like player abilities, items, new enemies, new characters, ranged characters, bosses, and levels. But those things will only come in due time in addition to hard work. I currently have some abilities finished for the player, but I decided to include that part of the development for the upcoming devlog. I hope you enjoyed the video and didn't find it too boring. It's the first time I've ever made a video like this, and it was a lot more fun and taxing than I expected it to be. I feel like I've gotten used to this whole game develop into video edit pacing, though, and the next time you see the devlog, it will definitely be more exciting and interesting. If you felt like any part was boring or fun, please let me know in the comments. It's how I improve, and I definitely want to improve. And if you've made it this far, thank you for watching until the end. If you want to keep up with the development of Treasure Porter's working title, hit the subscribe button and maybe even join my Discord server, which has like 5 or 6 people right now because I don't exactly advertise it, so that you can chat and play games with me. I know I haven't talked a lot about certain design elements or the direction of Treasure Porter's, but I think you guys will just have to wait for the upcoming devlog or join the Discord to find out. Thanks for watching. This is Bongohan signing off for today. Have a great day, and I'll see you next time. Thank you.